Good morning. You're welcome to Better Point United Methodist Church. As it says on the bulletin this time, my name is Mark Sadler and I'm the liturgist today. Sorry, Gary, you've been late. But anyway, welcome, and we do have a few announcements. Last week, someone regarding the angel tree gift tags, someone took number 18 last week. And I guess they didn't take the card melody or something. But anyway, whoever took number 18, if you go back and see Melody Monahan, she will fill you in on what she needs for that. And then also, it's time to order your poinsettias. And they are due by December 3rd. And I think they will be given out, Steve told me, right, on the 8th, I believe. And if you have any questions about the poinsettias, just get a hold of Steve Shirley. And then also, there are these flyers for the Christmas Family Fun Night. Now, some of you might have got one that says it's tonight. Well, that's not it. It's not tonight. Pastor Chipman's here. The real date is December 3rd from 3 to 6 p.m. And this is a card letting us know that you will be attending. And if you have any questions or want to help out with this, talk to Steve Shirley. And and also, if you're a visitor with us, we have these prayer cards. It's also an attendance card. And there's also stuff on there if you want to be a little bit more involved with the church or whatever. But at prayer time, we will collect these cards, and you can put down any prayers you would like for us to pray for, or anything that happened good in your life. So I can buy that for you. Besides that, I think that's it. And if you would like to prepare your hearts for worship, we will listen to some music for the lighting of the candles.
Thank you. Thank you.
will.
Good morning. Please be seated for just a moment. So I'm not Pat Jim Cook. I am Jeff Myers, and I'm going to be addressing words with you a little bit later here. And Pastor Chip, along with probably 8 or 9 women of our church, who served on the advanced team over at Brelsbury United Methodist Church, seeing some pretty special things happen over there. The opening music, I don't really get all that excited about music, you know, but and maybe for you, but for me, there are certain songs with which, when I hear them, I'm immediately in a state of worship. Shout to the Lord is probably my number one. Period. I mean, and it doesn't matter where I'm hearing it or whatever, I'm in worship. Blessed Assurance is special because often as we worship in Liberia, that's a song that's been sung. And it's a wonderful song to hear in a Liberian English lilt. And it's just a special opportunity. So, this morning we're going to dedicate the shoeboxes that you all put together for Samaritan's Purse, and so we've invited the children to come up with us today and to bring those shoeboxes forward and put them up front so they will come up at this time. Join us in prayers and dedicate these boxes. Lord, we are grateful for the opportunity to be able to take a little bit of what you've given to us and to share it with people around the world. Lord, these gifts will go into the hands of people that we don't even know, that we'll never meet. And we do that in faith. We do that with the knowledge that you already know where these boxes are going. You know that as each person prepared them, you knew where it was going. And you have a special person in mind to receive these gifts. We take great comfort and solace in that confidence and the faith that these will be delivered soon. Lord, when folks receive these, we ask that they receive them in the spirit in which they were intended. That is a spirit of love, a spirit of compassion, and a spirit of connection and representing you, being your hands and feet. It's really not important if the young folks that receive these know who put it together. They just need to know that it's an expression of your love to our hands and feet. Lord, we just ask that you bless these gifts, these tools, to be examples of your love throughout the world. All these things we ask in your precious Son. Amen. Amen. Folks, thank you for coming up. We appreciate that. I think Andrew's probably got a lesson for you that he wants to get to very quickly, so. Thank you.
Please join me in the call to worship. I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever.
Praise the Lord, most worthy of grace. His grace is no one can have.
The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love.
The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all
he has made. All you have made will praise you. O Lord, your saints will extol you.
My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Let every creature praise his holy name forever and ever.
Please join me in the opening prayer.
We thank you, O God, for the blessed assurance we have in your Son, Jesus Christ, who offered himself so freely. This blessed assurance extends to us mercy, grace, forgiveness, and life, all of which allow us to possess the hope that cannot be shaken. It allows us to sing praises unto you and celebrate your presence in our lives every moment.
and everything, though often we forget to say it, we are. To be grateful and happy hearts that we are blessed in the ways of God. Lord, we come in this time with a variety of praises. We come with a variety of needs. We have come with a variety of concerns for others, as well as ourselves. And Lord, we just ask that you be in the middle of all that. We know you already know about it. We have great confidence in that. We know that. Lord, we just ask that you stay in the right hand of it, and that you allow us to continue to be focused on you, and not on whatever it is that we may be going through, or others might be going through. Lord, we just ask that you stay focused on you, and allow you to be in the middle of whatever it is that's going on. Lord, we ask your blessing on each and every person in this place, the families around these people that are here, the folks that are members of the congregation and aren't here. We ask your blessing upon our leaders, on the world at large, and all of our children, Lord, that until the day comes that they all know you in a very personal way. Lord, we collectively celebrate and say the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Would the ushers please come forward?
Thank you.
Let's make sure that no one on the face of this earth will never know the assurance that your Father gave us of His love when He sent you down here, and for the assurance of our lifetime in the kingdom of heaven with you. Amen.
Amen.
The words that you've given me, the experiences that you've given me, could be used to be instructed this morning, and that as we share your words and my experiences, that folks may learn a little bit more about you and your priorities. All these things we ask for precious sons. So good morning, thank you for the privilege of sharing God's word with you this morning. Keep in mind, I am nothing more than a forgiven sinner. Sinner because I live in this world, and forgiven because of what Christ did on the cross, and my choice to accept his gift of grace. The bulletin has some space in there for any notes that you might want to jot down. I pray that because these words I believe are God's words, that there may be something worthwhile there. So we're going to start with a little game. The game is this. I want you to think about your most prized or most precious possession. Now, this can't be your spouse, it can't be a pet, it can't be a child, it can't be another living thing. It has to be an object, okay? So, some examples. Maybe you have a piece of furniture that really is precious to you. Maybe there's a chair, a bookcase, a table, maybe a bed. Maybe there's a piece of jewelry that was given to you by a loved one, a relative who passed it on from previous generations. Maybe it's a photograph. Perhaps it's a gift from another, maybe from grandchildren or children. Maybe it's your parents or grandparents. Maybe it's a piece of artwork that really speaks to you. Maybe it's a recognition that you worked very hard to achieve. Maybe it's a piece of sports memorabilia. Maybe it's that home run ball from the World Series game you went to. Maybe they're tickets from a special event. Maybe a souvenir from a vacation or a travel with a loved one. Or maybe it was a musical instrument given to you by another. I'm going to share with you this morning a few of my prized or precious possessions, and you may like them, you may not, but I get to talk, so you get to listen, so there you go. This is a shirt that I had made in Liberia on June 3rd of this year. There you go. I received several shirts over the years, you know, 6 trips to Liberia, a gift of a piece of clothing is a common gift. Unfortunately, they underestimate how big the white man is. So, we got this one custom made by tailors in Monrovia, and the thread work on it is done almost by hand. It's done with a machine, but it's the whole thing was done by hand. We watched it made, and they use a sewing machine where the bobbin moves, and they move the handle underneath the platform there on the sewing machine, and so all this scroll work is done literally by hand with the machine. So, kind of cool, but that's cool for me because I actually now have a Liberian shirt that I can get into, which is great. It's really wonderful. This right here, this is a recognition from Scouting. I had the privilege of serving as the course director for an advanced Scouting training course called WIBADGE. People who complete the course get a necklace with 2 beads. Those who serve as a course director get 4 beads within the Scouting movement. That's kind of cool. It's a piece of leather thong with 4 wooden beads. Intrinsically, it's worth about $8.62, okay? But because of the time it took me to get to that point and have that privilege of serving that course, and the time it took me to serve that course, that's pretty special. This is a Christmas ornament. It's just a heart with a bell on it. Joyce and I got this, I think at Ohio Village a number of years ago while we were dating or in our relationship. It's just kind of special because it's, you know, one of our early gifts. When I was a youth here in Groveport, I was active in the Order of DLA, one of the Sonic Youth Organizations, and I received the degree of Chevalier, and so that was part of my recognition for activities within that organization, so that's kind of special to me. I spent 7 years in college. No, I didn't do that to get a bachelor's degree, no, I spent 7 years in college, and I received my doctorate, so that was kind of cool, so the degree that I use and rely on every day to take care of people, that's pretty special and precious to me. This is just a Christmas ornament that I received from my grandson Slayton, and it's just a thumbprint heart. So he was like 2 years old, and he made a heart with his 2 thumbprints, and so that's pretty special, pretty precious, and kind of cool to me. And not to be outdone, Isla's also given us a number of gifts over the years. This one I really like because it's a picture of her and I, and she's just laughing her silly little head off. You know, because she's with Papa, of course, so that's special. Kind of cool. And she was 3 at the time. The Emmaus weekend that a number of our ladies are on this weekend, at the end of that, when I took my, did my walk in 2009, I received a cross. That's pretty special because of that experience that, I had there. I wear a watch that was given to me by my children and my wife for Father's Day a few years ago. It's way more than I would ever spend on a watch, but it's pretty cool. And then I wear a wedding band that my wife gave me 19 years, 2 months, and 15 days ago at this altar. Her promise, which she's been faithful enough to keep, and we're grateful for that. So those are some of my prized or precious possessions. Those of you who know me would note there are certain things I didn't share with you. Right? You say, well, Jeff, I don't see your Bible on that list. You're right. You might say, I don't see your wedding album. You're right. You don't see pictures of anything. You don't see my Eagle Scout medal. You don't see the honor medal I received from Scouting for attempting to save life. You don't see certificates of achievement for anything other than my degree. You don't see any artwork. You don't see any collectibles of any sort. Most of you know that we experienced a house fire on June 6th of this year. And that's 159 days ago today. And some of those things that I did not mention are not currently in our possession. Some are recovered and we will receive them back in time. Some are lost and we know that they're lost. Some are lost and we don't know if they're lost yet. So what about your precious possessions? What happens if you lost them? How would you feel? Would there be sorrow? Would you be sad? Would you be devastated? Would you be angry? Would you have grief? We did not fully understand the impact of the fire that morning. One of the firefighters who was on the scene said, you know, Jeff, this is really a small fire in our world. And the fire was contained in the kitchen, the ceiling of the kitchen, and the roof. It was extinguished pretty quickly and preserved the structure of the home and most of our possessions. The firefighters even took the time to remove some of our collectibles away from danger that night. You know, firefighters have the exciting part of the fire, Larry's. They get to come and battle the fire, they get to make sure it's out, then they get clean up, and then they're gone. They went to lunch, right? And they were got back in the firehouse a couple hours after they were dispatched. But they rarely get to see the after effects. And they rarely see the length of time it takes to restore things the way they were. Now, understand clearly that we are absolutely and positively grateful for every firefighter who arrived that morning and risked their safety to save our home. No question. But understand their role is simply on the front end of what is a very, very long process. You know, nobody gives you a handbook or guidelines about what to do after you have a fire. Everything in our house was either lost or so smoke damaged it just wasn't right. We have a very new appreciation for the folks in Houston who have been flooded out, the folks in Puerto Rico and Florida who have been displaced by hurricanes. We believe we have it much easier. We have a place to go back to. In the meantime, we have a place to live. We had multiple offers of places to stay on the night of the fire, some from folks within this room. We had an insurance adjuster and a construction firm on site the day after the fire. We have a support system. And the folks that were displaced in these other scenarios, they lost their local support system, right? Their neighbors, their friends, and their local family were all in the same situation that they were. And they offered no help. We left the house that evening with some clothes that would need to be washed, some toiletries that were given to us, each other, and that was pretty much it. And my attitude from that time till today is that everything is going to be okay. Whatever has been lost are simply possessions. No people were lost, no pets were lost, and believe me when I say that I was certainly more at peace after I confirmed our insurance was in force that day. And we really did not comprehend that morning or that day what had been lost. We lost all of our bedding, all of our cloth, all of our leather furniture, most of our electronics, all of our food, all carpeting, all cabinetry, all of our dishes, glassware, silverware, some cookware, some clothing, all sorts of little stuff, all of our appliances, all toiletries, makeup, soap, cleaning, and sediment, a variety of work. We've had to place a value on about 500 items. And it's worth more than I would have ever guessed. Most of it is just stuff. Some things were more sentimental than others, But all in all, it's just stuff.
Have you ever watched a couple kids wrestle over a stuffed animal or a toy? You'll hear them say, "It's mine." The other one will say, "No, it's mine." Pretty soon they're wrestling, and it might even be a fight that ensues, right? Each thinks they're fighting for their own possession and ownership of it. Have you ever gotten a scratch in that new car? Were you inflamed about the damage? Did you yell and scream? Were you fired up? What would happen if that precious prized possession that you thought about earlier disappeared? What if that piece of jewelry that your great-grandmother had broken or lost? What if somebody spilled Coca-Cola or red wine on the handwork that your mother had made? What if that home run baseball got a muddy fingerprint on it? What if your uncle's banjo that he played for years all over the country was lost due to a broken water pipe? Or what if 500 of your possessions were lost in the morning fire on a beautiful, clear June morning, and the remains of your kitchen end up in your yard, and you leave your house not knowing that you will not be living in your home for 10 to 11 months? Let me ask you a question. All those prized and precious possessions, how many of them will you be taking with you when you die? If you've ever had the opportunity to manage the possessions of a person who, after their passing, you understand and have experienced that the prized and precious possessions of the one who has passed generally do not have the same prized value to others, especially those outside of family. It might be the table that your great-great-grandparents bought in Pennsylvania as a wedding gift to one another and brought with them when they traveled here to Ohio. It's been passed through the family to your mom. It's a prized possession in the family. But to anyone outside the family, it's just an antique table. Prior to the fires, we would make substantial purchases. I would often think, what would happen if we lost this? Would I be okay? My answer was yes. Because I've come to understand that they're not my possessions. For now, I am simply the steward of this stuff. Well, I get to use the dishes, I get to watch the TV, I get to sit on the couch, I get to sleep in the bed, I get to enjoy the artwork. But when I die, these things aren't going with me. It would take two moving vans, and they're not willing to dig a hole in the bag big enough to put all that stuff in. All that stuff will stay here. And in some cases, that stuff's going to be trash and it's going to get thrown away. In some cases, that stuff will become somebody else's to be a steward of for a while. And some of it, a few of those things, might become precious possessions for my children or my grandchildren. Our scripture for today comes out of Luke 12. Now, Luke was a physician who did not know Jesus, and he wrote the gospel by interviewing people who did know Jesus. He was very careful in his writing of this gospel. Chapter 12 is a series of messages from Jesus. First, he gives warnings to his disciples. Then he fields a question from the crowd of thousands. He then teaches his disciples about worry, about being prepared, about peace. And then he returns to instructing the crowd. It's a chapter full of instruction on trusting God, how to handle abundance, how to handle worry, where your treasure should be, and being ready for the arrival of the Son of Man. These verses we're studying today are pretty direct instruction from Jesus about possessions. A request comes from somebody asking Jesus to tell the person's brother to divide an inheritance, and Jesus rejects the role of judge. He says, "No, I ain't doing it. Well, not my job." His comment is to them is this: watch out. Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. He then goes on to say, life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. Now that instruction for the people in the crowd is just as valid today as it was for them. Valuing possessions more than people, valuing possessions more than relationships, valuing possessions more than God, in Jesus' words, is a form of greed. He specifically warns against highly valuing possessions. He's saying that life is more than just a bunch of stuff. Having a bunch of stuff when you know of a need in your family, or a need of a friend, or the need of a neighbor, or dare I say, someone you don't even know, If you don't address it, that's greed. And that's what Jesus is warning against. When your stuff owns you, that's greed. And that's what Jesus is warning against. When you're not content with what you have and are compelled and driven to have more stuff, that's greed. And that's what Jesus is warning against. Now note that he didn't say possessions are bad. The scripture says, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. I firmly believe that part of life is being able to, witness and share with others our experiences when we go through trials. Most commonly we see this in circumstances involving the death of a loved one, especially a spouse. It can also be seen in situations where relationships dissolve or an addiction is involved. You may have experienced this when you've had a difficult situation, or maybe you've helped another. We share with one another how we worked through that difficulty and came through it. This support provides others with the hope that they can work through difficulties. That hope that tough circumstances will be overcome. That hope that we can persevere. The hope that a widower or a divorcee can love again. The hope that an addiction can be beat one day at a time. The hope that a home can be rebuilt and that a house fire will not define our lives. That kind of hope comes from our faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's not in our individual strength. It is the faith that Christ promised from the very end of the Gospel of Matthew, where he says, I'm with you always to the very end of the age. You see, my faith, does not lie in a sofa or a suit or a bedroom or bedroom furniture or cookware or gifts or art or recognitions or a house. No, my faith lies in the living Christ. What I can now share with you from personal experience in a very real way is that all that stuff, prized or not, precious or not, all of it can be gone in no time. And while it might sadden us, Jesus Christ still loves us, our family still loves us, and life goes on. As I said at the beginning, I'm nothing more than a forgiven sinner. I'm far from perfect, and I'm special only because Jesus loves me and has blessed me way more than this sinner deserves to be blessed. As people have asked us how we are after the fire, I have answered in clear conscience and with confidence, we are okay. We are okay. And some people have looked at me in disbelief that we could be okay after essentially losing our home, being displaced for 10 months, and losing a whole bunch of stuff. But we are okay. Because our faith and our value does not lie in the stuff that we've been blessed to steward in this life. Our faith is in Jesus Christ. So I've shared a little bit about me. What about you? Does your faith and value lie in the stuff you have? The closet full of shoes? The DVDs of every superhero movie known to man? A beautiful car that you can't drive in the rain because it might get wet? Or the perfect clothes that hang in your closet? Or does your faith and value lie in the man who went to the cross so your sin could be erased? Now, before you jump to answer that, like the wise second grader who knows that a great answer to those questions in church is Jesus, just ask yourself how you would react if that closet full of shoes was gone overnight. All the DVDs were lost in the fire, if the car was stolen and never found, if all your perfect clothes were in a flood and underwater for a week and lost. How easy would it be for you to give it up? Could you say we really are okay? And if you could say that, how long would it take for you to say that? Those answers are the true answers to the question of how closely are you attached to your stuff. I'm no more special than any of you, but I do now speak from experience when I tell you that placing your faith and your value into stuff that can be gone in seconds is foolish. Listen to what Jesus said about this. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. Let go of your attachment to the stuff. Live a life in the abundance of the grace offered by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is here always. Yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Amen.
Thank you.
assurance that God loves you in a powerful way, that He wants to be with you, that He wants to be part of your life. And understand that all the stuff that we get worried about, all the possessions, are just stuff. And let's focus on the relationships and the people in our lives. And do this in response to
Amen. I just have a couple announcements real quick. Just a reminder, the Lillian Faith Circle are selling bread and knives in the fellowship hall after service. And then also, if anyone would like to come and help at the end of service to help load these shoe boxes into some bins, they're right down here inside this door. If people come down, I'll just load these up so we can get them off and you can enjoy your Sunday.